Welcome back to our Proactive Studios. I'm Natalie Stoberman, joined by the Senior Advisor at EQM Indexes, Steve Derkash. And Steve, how are you doing today?
Great, Natalie. Good morning. Good to see you. Thanks for having me back.
Good to see you too. And we get to chat about some big news from the EU, taking a new, more ambitious stance on renewable energy. What's your take on this update there, Steven?
Yeah, it's a reaffirmation by the EU of their leadership position when it comes to green energy and clean energy. Recently, a couple of weeks ago, the EU Parliament and the Council reached a provisional agreement to increase their renewable power targets up to 42.5% by 2030. This is up from 32% of all their power will now be renewable. It's really one step closer to completing the Fit for 55 legislation, which is reducing greenhouse gas emissions by 55% versus the 1990 levels. Really, it reaffirms the desire for one, energy independence, and two, to meet the 55% reduction targets. It's a big deal. It continues to be important for solar because solar plays an important role in the energy transition, being really the cheapest form of new energy build out there. So it really goes a long way towards helping the EU. They recently also had the Repower EU pass, which aims to increase solar by 100% by 2025 and by three times by 2030.
And Steven, this industry is still in a transitional phase. When it comes to keeping in the line of growth, the International Renewable Energy Agency has said that global investments in energy transition technologies must more than quadruple annually in line to stay with commitments made under the Paris Climate Accord. That's a big number to be able just to be in a transition phase. What does this mean for solar in the long term, but also being able to have the money to keep the investments coming in?
Well, I think what the International Renewable Energy Agency announced by saying these targets and what's needed to reach clean energy and net zero targets around the world, it really reemphasizes the massive amount of capital that is needed to reach these net zero targets around the world. So last year in 2022, investments in renewable energy technologies exceeded a trillion for the first time ever. And this also was the first time that it exceeded the amount of capital going into fossil fuel industries. So what's happening is you're seeing a recognition that there needs to be an acceleration of investment of capital at the early stage, all the way up to the mature stage to get these technologies out. The International Renewable Energy Agency, in addition to saying that investments need to quadruple annually from about $1 trillion now to $5 trillion to meet the key Paris Accord targets of limiting temperature increases to 1.5 degrees Celsius. They're saying that about $35 trillion needs to be invested by 2030. This includes improving energy efficiency, electrification, grid expansion. Right now, you're seeing new energy projects in China, the EU, and the US take up the lion's share of this, about two-thirds of all investment. The real issue now is really trying to now transition over to the developing world. This is where it's lacking. So I think you're going to see an increased focus, not only in the developed world, but also in the emerging world.
Yes, very critical time period right now just to get renewable energy off the ground worldwide. But there were still some banking scares, and I'm curious to see what is your outlook on how the solar industry has been able to adapt to what's been happening financially around the world.
Yeah, well, as you alluded to, with the failure of Silicon Valley Bank, they funded 60% of community solar. I think they had over 1,500 solar battery storage, carbon capture companies in their portfolio that they were involved with. So, I think the concern was that this would create a void. I think what you're going to see, though, are the larger banks and also the the non-banks, so the funds out there, venture capital, really step in to fill the void of any smaller banks that may have hit turbulence. give you an example, JP Morgan has announced that they're on track to finance $1 trillion for green energy by 2030. They've invested about nearly $200 billion in green initiatives over the last 2 years and have targeted to finance an additional $800 billion by 2030. So it's really unlocking, you know, business opportunities in two vital areas. One on the production side, which would be solar. Capital is needed to develop and deploy all the clean energy solutions. And then on the use side, we're going to need a lot of financing to grow the business across the value chain. That could be EV, battery, carbon capture and storage is another issue. So I think you're going to see the bigger banks try to fill this void. It's a very attractive opportunity with trillions of investment that are needed. And so while it is a little bit of a hiccup and something to monitor, I think it will be, the void will be filled by the larger banks.
Yes, it's been crazy times for sure, but we appreciate your outlook on all that's been happening in the solar industry. Thank you so much for joining us, Stephen.
Thank you, Natalie.
Again, the senior advisor at EQM Indexes, Stephen Derkash.